I'm making sandwiches. Nice. I was in Hanif's shop the other day. He was saying he wants to come back on. Shoot him some dates. Yeah, salt, pepper, ketchup. It's what you get. It's what you get. I said, what you see. It's what you get. Not that. It's what you get. And real. Looks pretty good, dude. Mm-hmm. That's a good looking sandwich. The best thing.
I want one of those.
Yeah. That looks really good, man. I like that, Charlie.
Thank you.
Thanks, man. Hey, yo, what's going on, everybody? Joey C in the place to be. I got a big boombox and a new CD coming at you live from the GFY studios with the authentic only show, the AO show. Here we are doing the damn thing again. Just talking about it. We've been doing this over a year now.
Yeah.
Long time. Hanif Collins, first guest. When did it drop? March, May?
It must have been March.
Yeah, because we did it in February.
Yeah.
Right on. I'm just talking to him and he wants to come back on. So another return guest. Nice. Here today with Charlie doing a damn thing over there. Just shot some new promo video. What do you call it? Intro video?
Yeah, a little intro.
Right on. Lisa Howe making sandwiches at the GFY, pork roll, egg, and cheese, SPK. Mm. Looking delicious. I have one or two today. You have one, right?
One. I got one for later.
One for later? I don't know how you don't eat a sandwich. If it's there, I'm going to eat it.
I would. Yeah, I don't know. I just.
The self-control, Charlie. It's beautiful. Admirable.
Thank you.
Right on. And today's guest, Bethel Dwayne Spence. What's going on, man?
Not a whole lot.
Right on, man.
Just
thanks
here,
for coming.
Hanging with you guys.
Doing the damn thing. I see you've brought an instrument of sorts as well, too. Look at that. Maybe some live music in the studio for the first time. We'll give it a shot. Do the damn thing. Cool, man.
I have confidence, Charlie. He looks confident.
Absolutely. Look at him. Very confident. Look. I think it's the haircut. Right on.
Thank you.
Cool, man. Thanks for coming in. I don't want to get in the habit of summarizing people. So if you can, tell the people who you are and what it is you do.
My name is Bethel Dwayne Spence, and I live here in Vancouver, Washington. My hometown now, from North Carolina originally.
Right on.
North Carolina and South Carolina. So the better part of my life, Oak Island, okay. North Carolina. And then as I kind of grew into my teens, was down in South Carolina quite a bit. Wow. Columbia, South Carolina, mm-hmm. Charleston, South Carolina.
Wow.
Yeah, beautiful places.
Yeah, man, both of them.
I can't say enough about the coast there,
yeah,
honestly.
That's nice.
It would take us a long time.
Yeah, man.
I work around town. I run a window cleaning business. We also do a lot of exterior cleaning type stuff as well, residential, commercial. That's my Monday through Friday. On the weekends, play a lot of music with a couple really good friends of mine who are from back east as well, who one of them went to school with me there in South Carolina, and a couple other guys that we met out here, California and other places.
Right.
So, yeah, we're called Lincoln's Beard.
Right.
And you can check us out at lincolns.beard on Instagram. And also our SoundCloud, Lincoln's Beard SoundCloud. You go to that, there's probably about 75 songs that you can listen to for free.
Oh, wow.
You can also, you know, find it on any of your streaming services as well. So I tend to really lean towards loving the music.
Right on.
Maybe other people would like it as well.
Outstanding. Beautiful. Yeah, anybody from... the Vancouver downtown area, you know, you've seen posters and you guys play downtown frequently, right? Did you have a spot at Brick House for a while?
We've done the Brick House quite a bit. Mm-hmm. Over the years, we've done some McMenamins. We had a residency there at the White Eagle for a while.
Oh, nice.
A few years back. And we've also done, I don't know if it's still there, Secret Society Ballroom. We had a residency there for quite a while. We've done a lot of places here and there, mm-hmm. but when it comes to sort of local places that we play the most, mm-hmm. you know, right down the street would be the Brick House for sure.
Right on.
But we're willing to play anywhere. I mean, we played out in front of the Ronald Records last Saturday for Record Store Day.
What time did you guys get there?
We got there about 6 o'clock in the morning.
I was gonna say I was here a little before six, and there was 40 people online, and you guys were out there, and I was like, "What in the wide world of sports is going on? They're giving something away."
Yeah, yeah. We set up and played two sets, one at sunrise, and then another one around 9:30.
Right on.
Yeah, it was a lot of fun. The juxtaposition of the quiet sort of morning with the just amplified band. It was really nice. It was something I've really wanted to do for a while. And then John asked, you know, if we would do it. And I thought, wow, my dream came true.
Look at that. Keep dreaming. Beautiful.
Yeah. I still want to hit that alley, though.
The
one with all the nice artwork in it.
Right. Oh, here. When
right beside Kindred.
Yeah, when Kindred has the event going on. Yeah, that's a nice little.
No, with no one in there.
With nobody in there.
Full just band with a huge.
Right on.
Right. Yeah. At 6 a.m.
I could dig it. You could probably pull that off. Yeah.
Yeah.
They had one giant event back there one time, when Schofield was still involved with the. I mean, they still own it, but when the guitar shop was in where Kindred was. They had big, huge stage and everything. We went out there and made pizza in the fucking rain. It was terrible. But there was a shit ton of people out there. It was a pretty decent-sized event.
Yeah.
And then they moved to Nashville. Because
the guitar guys.
Yeah, guitar people. Yeah,
yeah. Guitar makers.
Yeah.
Yeah.
They made some nice pieces. Nothing I could afford.
Yeah.
But they were in it, so they were doing the damn thing. But, yeah, you could definitely make that happen. Keep dreaming, right? It'll happen.
I'm looking forward to it. I figure we should just do it and just set up, you know, and then deal with it later,
yeah,
you know?
I like that idea.
By the time the police got there, anyone really significantly was doing it, you could be like 8 songs in. Hmm. It wouldn't even really matter if they shut you down around 10 songs in. You'd be like, cool, we got at least like 40 minutes in.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Playing music, I can shut you down.
I know where some power is too. That's the only reason I keep scoping it out, because there's free power if you go up the side of the building. We just get a ladder.
Oh yeah.
There you go. I'm sure you could run some cables too. Alex might be into it. Just saying, you guys could figure it out. Yeah, man, I could dig it. I noticed there was some barbed wire up on the roof recently too. A guy that climbed up there and hung from the power lines that one Saturday afternoon, I guess.
So oh,
they
yeah.
made some adjustments. But it is what it is. That's the past. We're not looking in the crystal ball.
Yeah, he had a good time.
Something, man. That dude was in shape, man. He was hanging for 45 minutes or something, close to an hour.
Right.
People were, you know, sending me all kinds of videos because it was right outside the shop.
Yeah.
And I was looking at this guy. I was like, man, it's not an easy position to hang in for very long. And he was up there a while. So.
Mm-hmm. His dismount was just a little bit off, but I mean.
Exactly.
He looked like something was going to. He looked. As if he was going to pull something off pretty incredible.
Hmm.
But he landed on his back.
Low scores from the Russian judge on the dismount. It happens. Can't win them all. Right on, man. Cool, cool. Yeah, so how do we come into the circle? I mean, I've seen you around and whatnot. I guess coming through soliciting, cleaning the windows and whatnot, yeah? I think you came through at the right time, too, because I remember I had somebody in line, and they kept shitting the bed, and you popped up right at the right time.
Yeah, I came into your place, but I'd seen you at another place. You stopped by. You were with your daughter.
Oh, that's right. You were doing Brick House, yeah.
And mm-hmm. you asked if this was my company, and I said, yeah. And you said, you should stop by. So then I came in, yeah, mm-hmm. when you guys were kind of – we were always kind of busy as long as this place is open.
exactly.
And you were just like, yeah, get it done.
Yeah, man.
Do it. I started trying to tell you. Everything I was going to do, and you were like, I trust you. Just do it.
Yeah, do the thing, man. Yeah. I mean, I saw you doing your job, so I was like, yeah, you could do it, man. That's cool. We went to a couple different companies, and one person in particular, and somebody died, and the companies didn't work out, and it needed to get done. Mm-hmm. It seems like a good bag, too, because, you know, everybody's got a tremendous amount of windows on the block.
Yeah, and they're dirty all the time.
Yeah.
You know, coffee shops, restaurants, mm-hmm. bars, gyms. I do a lot of gyms.
Oh, gyms.
Those are nice.
I didn't think about that. Yeah.
Yeah.
Stinky, sweaty people in there getting mm-hmm. all nasty.
Yeah. Yeah.
Right on.
So, yeah, there's an extraordinary amount of glass everywhere.
Yeah, man. It gets dirty quick. I mean, I don't like cleaning windows. I've had to do it a couple times here. You know, I got the gear for it and whatnot, but I was like, man. I'm going to pay somebody to do it. So thank you, sir.
Yeah, it makes a lot of sense to have them professionally done, though.
Yeah.
You know, it mm-hmm. just because it gets done really well. And if you have it done like you do, you mm-hmm. know, on a regular basis, your place is just always clean, you know?
Yeah.
And when people are walking in, they're walking out, they don't really not notice so much when they're clean, you know? But when they're dirty, people are like, oh, those windows are disgusting.
Yeah.
So it makes a difference, even though it's you know, not something that people bring up often.
Mm-hmm. I notice it, you know, specifically there's a couple of tables that are near the windows and, you know, kids sit there or whatnot and they got pizza and cheese and sauce all over it. You come in, it's like,
love those.
Why is there, I want to apologize for the noise next door again. Looks like they're building Noah's Ark over there or something again. This by hand. But yeah, I'll come in and be like, ah, so we got to touch it every once in a while, but you know, it's only 3 foot high sometimes. Hit it with the Windex. Yeah, man. Those clear story windows, those ones up there. Those are tough sometimes too, but.
They're very thin too. Yeah. You know, a lot of windows, I don't think yours are, but one thing that's trippy around Vancouver, there's a lot of windows made by Ford Motor Company. Like a lot of the old ones.
No shit.
Yeah. You look in the bottom little thing and it's Ford Motor Company glass. Huh.
Wow.
I don't know how that came about. But if they're old windows, you know, yours may not. I mean, yours are certainly old. What am I talking about?
The two on the one side, when we pulled them out, we had to replace them because they were so old. The city said, like, you got to get XYZ certified windows to get in there. But we had to pull them out to get the oven in. But the one on the left and all the clear story windows, or the right, if you're looking at the door, all the clear story windows are the ones that were in there. So they're probably old. I mean, the building's old as shit, 100 years, you know. There's a Westinghouse circuit over there from, like, 1928 or something like that. Still working. Electricians come down here. They're like, don't ever change that. That's going to work forever. So, all right, man. I'm not going to go near it. So, but, yeah, old building, old stuff. That's cool. Ford Motor Company making glass. Guess they had a piece of everything back in the day.
Right, yeah, and it probably just made sense. They were making it, so they might as well just make it for everybody.
Yeah, man.
Yeah.
Get a piece where you can. So Lincoln Spirit, playing music around town. How long have you been playing music?
With this band, this is 18 years.
Damn, dude.
2006 we started.
Wow.
Yeah, here in Vancouver. Our first gig was at the Historical Museum.
Wow.
For the, they do a yearly event. It used to happen in the parking lot across the street where New Seasons is.
Okay.
Years ago.
That was empty for a long time.
Right. Yeah. And so they would do their sort of yearly celebration harvest fest thing, and that they would bring the stuff from WSU to that parking lot. And then you could go back and forth from the museum to the, or the, you know, field across where the New Seasons is. Mm-hmm. And that's where they had all the plants and, you know, vegetables are the, not a harvest fest. It was the plant sale they do.
Mm-hmm.
So anyway, the then they moved that up to where they have the WSU thing on 78th Street.
Okay, now, yeah.
Mm-hmm. Is where that whole thing happens now. But at the time, my point here is that they do that event each year. And at the time, we were playing it each year. Mm-hmm. And so we played first there in the lobby of the Historical Museum. It was our very first gig. And then as the years passed, we would end up there at 78th Street. On the actual farm.
Right on.
Playing.
Heritage Farm, yeah.
Yeah.
Pretty cool.
Heritage Farm. Right. See, I should have remembered that. I need to remember.
It was something on a podcast not too long ago when we were talking to Jordan about that. So
it's a neat place. There's so much going on there. Mm-hmm. You know, you really could get into a lot of information with all the different things they're doing with WSU, but also the community and whatnot and the museum and all. It's just, yeah. A lot of motivated people out there at Heritage Farm.
Yeah, man. Yeah, I know they got a veterans program out there, kids program. I've had people like trying to do an internship and whatnot through that. It's been, they've reached out a couple times. It's pretty cool. A lot of good stuff going on. Other people, I know Jordan had mentioned about trying to link that up somehow to have like a farm incubator, which would be really great. But we'll see what shakes out. Hopefully live music and farm festival still, too.
Yeah.
Right on, man.
Our next gig is May 10th with Lincoln Spirit at the Brick House.
Oh, right on.
Yeah. We're playing with a band called Resurgence. They're five teenage girls that live kind of Brush Prairie area. And they're folky type young ladies, but they're all sisters.
Oh, wow.
It'd be interesting. Yeah. So that's May 10th. The whole thing will start right around 6 o'clock in the evening, go to about like 10 or 11.
Nice. So put it on your calendars, people.
But there's many gigs beyond that.
I'm sure.
I say we got probably 10 more listed for the summer.
Mm-hmm.
Do a really cool one up in Ridgefield called, you know where Three Peaks is? Tap House up there. There's a fish house as well.
Oh, yeah, yeah. I was just talking about that place yesterday. Place to go get food, that Pacific Northwest Best Fish.
Yes.
Yeah, it's like a little trailer where they deep fry stuff. It's delicious.
Oh, my gosh.
I always forget about it, too. Yeah.
Yeah, I know. You can easily forget about it because it's just out of the way. Mm-hmm. But it's a neat spot. It's a destination.
Mm-hmm.
Well, they do a concert series each year. And so we'll be part of that concert series each weekend.
Indoor, outdoor?
Outdoor.
Cool.
In the field next door. Yeah, it's really nice. They bring a couple bartenders and stuff outside so that you can get your beers and whatnot outside as opposed to walking into the building or whatever. If you want to just sit and chill and watch the music the whole time.
Nice. A veritable festival. Look at that. Nice. Food, music, beers. And fun times. Oh. How'd you get into music?
I just started playing guitar, you know, probably a little bit in high school, but not much, learning a few chords here and there. Once I got out of high school, you know, I spent a lot of time in dorm room and apartments and stuff playing music and smoking a lot of pot with people, probably doing not a whole lot of schoolwork.
You were learning in other ways.
Yeah. But it really became a lot of fun and a good way to get a lot of creative energy out.
Mm-hmm.
I was never a great artist in regards to like drawing or painting or sculpting or anything. But I did feel like I had something in me. And so it was something that inspired me to kind of continue to explore art in general, you know. So I continued to draw and try to paint, you know, never got really good at it. I done some watercolors and stuff that I was proud of here and there. But music kind of kept me in that vein. Otherwise, I probably would have just ditched any kind of art and would have been doing something totally different with my life. At least I feel that way. I don't know. Might not have happened. But started trying to figure out how to write songs. So once I don't, you know, if there's anyone listening to this or if you guys can, like, you know, yourselves think of this, once that becomes like an addicting art, you're constantly trying to find out little ways to make things work. So it's like a puzzle. And you always think that the next one you do is better than the last one. Mm-hmm. So you're always chasing it, you know?
Yeah.
And so sometimes you like the song, sometimes you don't like them. Sometimes you forget the ones you love because it's been too long since you played them.
Mm-hmm.
Sometimes you have an idea for 4 or 5 years, you know, before you can really flush it out in a way in your head where it just comes to you. And those things just really kept me playing, you know, more and more and joining bands recording music and I often think of to myself that maybe it's not really good to I don't know what I would do if I had like arthritis really bad or my fingers were chopped off and for some reason or I lost it and wouldn't be able to play music, play guitar at least, you know, so.
Play with your feet.
Play with your feet, yeah. Well, I don't know.
This cat's
I just
do that.
Don't know. I often think that I don't know if life would be worth living at that point, man, you know. It's kind of, it's weird. I think about it more now because I am 48 years old.
Mm-hmm.
I'm not old by any stretch. I mean, in my brain, I mean, if you're younger than me, then you probably think I am old. If you're older than me, you think I'm young.
Yeah, exactly. Perspective.
But I do think about, you know, that in 10 years or more, you know, so, and that can come really quick, you know, that I will have issues with my hands and arms and shoulders and, you know, and things like that that will start affecting in some way. And I just really, really fear that I wouldn't be able to make music. So I have been playing with this little keyboard lately to learn how to play piano somewhat, nice. You know, mm-hmm. so that I can at least just bang on one of those if shit gets too bad.
I can dig it, man.
Yeah, it's a weird fear to have, you know, and people have bigger problems in the world. I feel very privileged to even have that fear.
It's cool stupid. To pick up. I mean, it's legitimate, too. You know, it's,
yeah.
You know, Dennis, who we just had on, he's a comedian, and he used the exact same word. He's addicted to comedy. You know, when he doesn't do it, he feels like he needs to be creating, getting out there and doing the damn thing. Mm-hmm. You know, if you're expressing your creativity and you don't do that or can't do that, I don't think it would stop. It's a legitimate fear, but if that is inside you and you need to get it out, it's going to come out in some way, shape, or form. You'll find some way to express it. From my perspective, you know, you're saying you're taking up, you know, keyboards to mitigate that fear, maybe. But, you know, you could sing or play a different instrument, or, you know, with technology nowadays, put a straw in your mouth and hit a sample button and hit the next one.
Yeah.
Yeah, there's ways to go about it.
I could bang on some stuff.
Yeah, man.
Just play some drums.
Yeah, exactly. Just bang on some drums.
Yeah, man. I'd probably figure something out.
Yeah, man. You know, I played a little bit of music, but I always found I was never much, you know, I was at a certain level, but when I really wanted to sit down and develop a song, I played mostly guitar, but when I really wanted to get into, like, I'm going to write the music to this song, the keyboard was the one that I found was the, I want to say the easiest, just because it, like, everything is there in front of you. There it is, and you can mm-hmm. just hit the buttons, you know? It wasn't like when I grabbed the guitar, I felt kind of locked up by the keyboard and or by the fretboard and what I knew. Like, I knew these chords, I knew this, instead of making up a, like, maybe I want this chord. Well, I didn't know what that was on the piano, so I would just keep plunking around until I heard the one that I wanted.
Right.
Like, oh, yeah, that chord has a name, but I couldn't translate that to the fretboard on the keyboard. Didn't yeah. matter. It was like, boom, there it is. You know,
man, I almost prefer that, like, the less knowledge people mm-hmm. get, a little bit more creative.
Absolutely.
Once you start to know too much and you can understand, then you know? Mm-hmm. When I first started playing bass guitar, I didn't know how to play bass, but I knew how to play acoustic guitar, but I didn't know how you supposed to really, you know, I had an idea, mm-hmm. you know, follow along with the drummer, try to, mm-hmm. I listened to some of the stuff back then. I feel like my bass lines were a little bit more interesting because I was making them up by ear mm-hmm. as opposed to now being like, okay, well, you know, what are the chords, you know, yeah, tell me yeah. what that breakdown is there. And then I kind of just follow along with the band. Which is really cool as well. I like that. Locking in with the drummer and, you know, but, yeah, when I didn't know as much, I was just kind of hanging on by a thread, mm-hmm. right? So it was much more interesting, it seems.
Yeah.
I prefer both, though. I mean, but I don't know how to get back to that, though, of the not knowing.
The unlearning, yeah.
Yeah.
That's funny you bring that up. I was just listening to a podcast. You know, I mentioned this on a couple podcasts before about the ecological approach, like ecological approach to psychology and learning, and these guys that are exploring sport at a very high level on this ecological approach. They distinctly said it's more like an unlearning of what you know, and that puts you into a different place. It's like, oh, I'm going to go out there and do this move. Well, that's putting you in a mindset where, like, that's where your attention is. I'm going to go out and do this move. But if you're going out there going with the intention of, well, I'm going to do this instead of this little specific thing, I'm going to go out there and have this bigger goal, and it opens many more doors. So unlearning this one little technique or move that you know now opens up the universe to exploring
it. It's very much the way of the Tao.
Yeah.
It's Taoism. Mm-hmm. It's a natural just from one moment to the next. Mm-hmm. That's what feels so good about that type of breakthrough when you're doing something. And people will sometimes, I believe, okay, I was just watching a lot of basketball today.
Yeah.
You know, when the guy gets the hot hand and it starts to And they're like, we just don't know, you know. And one of the players just starts to go off.
Give him the ball.
And it's just he's very much in the moment, mm-hmm. and he's just going from moment to moment, and it's working out for him, mm-hmm. because there's other people that are a little too stressed out, mm-hmm. and a little too like wanting to win the game. Mm-hmm. This guy is in a different zone at that time, and whether it's called the hot hands or the way of the Tao, mm-hmm. or whatever, you know, but mm-hmm. it's very much that. And I
flow state is another way to put it. Yeah.
Flow state. Mm-hmm. Yeah. It's hard to get there. Consciously. Mm-hmm. You just hope that you can, do something enough to where you get at least, good enough at it to where you can just do it without thinking about it. And then all of a sudden you're just there. Mm-hmm. And maybe not all the time, you know. Sometimes playing music, you're on stage just having a wonderful time, and you're in that state of flow. But if you start to think about something else, or you start to get a little nervous about this next piece of the song, and you're just out of it, you know. And it sucks.
Yeah, it can crumble really quickly.
Right, yeah, yeah. So it's such a crazy balance to, you just don't want to know, but you need to know.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, man. Constant exploration. That's beautiful.
Moment to moment to moment. Mm-hmm. But you don't need to know before the next moment. Mm-hmm. And you don't need to think about the last moment. Mm-hmm. It's the moment to moment, you know?
Yeah.
I smoke too much of that.
No, you're right on it, man. Yeah, it's not necessarily the note you just played, which may be a wrong note. It's the one that comes after it.
Right.
That can make that one sound right. You
know? Whatever you're doing, yeah, don't stop.
Yeah, exactly. Don't give
up. The only thing worse than, like, stopping in a race or stopping in the middle of the song, you know, the only thing worse than falling in a race or hitting the wrong note is if you stop. Mm-hmm. If you don't, you just have to keep going, yeah. No matter what.
Yeah, man.
You make it through the moments. People don't care.
Yeah. I can dig it. And if they care, they can go fuck themselves. Right on, man. Yeah, being on stage and hitting some wrong notes. I've been there, man. It can be a terrifying moment, but make a funny face and just power through it.
Yeah, yeah. And sometimes, you know, you can only hope you got people around you that are supportive, so that they don't squash your creative vibe,
true.
Right? Of yeah. whatever, you know, if after the show everyone's pissed off because you did hit a couple of those, you're like, well, hell, this is now a lot of pressure.
Yeah, exactly.
You know, I may get more notes wrong.
Mm-hmm.
I may quit this fucking band.
Yeah, man. Exactly. Some bands really embrace the blahs, too. I mean, what's his name? Fancy Funkin' Hunter guy. Ted Nugent.
Oh, right.
He said, when he was playing with Damn Yankees, he was like, yeah, we fucking embrace the blahs. We leave all the fucking mistakes in there and shit. I was like, that's pretty fucking profound, dude. I like that.
Yeah. You know, I listened to Rick Rubin talk recently about recording Crazy Horse, Neil Young's band.
Mm-hmm.
And he said he went in and he was like, this is horrible. These guys don't know how to play.
Hmm.
They don't know their songs. And then he realized that, like, the whole vibe that they project is that they're a rowdy, kind of rough around the edges, kind of bar band sound. And they've always been that way. But he wasn't a big Crazy Horse connoisseur. He didn't know a whole lot about them, you know. He probably said, but once Neil Young got there and the whole thing starts to come together and he's singing along with them and he's going back and being like, oh, okay, this is who these guys are. This is Crazy Horse.
Mm-hmm.
And if I try to polish this up and make it like something new or something fancy or something slick, it's going to be on me. Mm-hmm. Because they know Crazy Horse isn't doing that. You know, they play the way they play.
Yeah.
So I don't know. And it's always been a joke for years that, you know, that Crazy Horse was a horrible band.
Hmm.
So I think Rick Rubin just caught up with everyone else on that. But they're not a horrible band.
No, not
they're
at
just
all.
They're just a raucous, they're a bar band, mm-hmm. and they're cool.
Yeah, they got their thing, and they do it, and, you know, they made bunches of records and bunches of money.
Yeah.
You know? Everybody in this room knows who they are.
Yeah. The only bar band that plays sold out shows.
Yeah, exactly, right? That's good.
In huge stadiums.
Yeah, man. Yeah, some real players too. Hey, man, different styles, different strokes. How would you describe your, I don't like to, you know, put stuff into categories, but how would you describe the music that you guys play or you play and Lincoln's Beard? Well, or a genre you would say or?
Yeah, well, we call it just, you know, when we first started out, it was a little bit like, we had banjo, mandolin, piano, and so it was a much different, there was a trumpet in there.
Wow.
Much different band if you were to listen to the first two or three albums, I think. And so at that time, we called it urgent folk because it was fast and kind of punky at times, and it had this this kind of vibe that was like, oh, these guys definitely aren't like, you know, pickers or whatever, but they're sitting here playing banjos and mandolins and stuff. But we were wrenching on them like they were hammer, you know. Like,
right on.
I mean, it was pretty ham-fisted, but really cool songs, though. And so over time, though, we kind of morphed into sort of more like a folk rock band.
Right on.
We do some sort of punk vibe on some songs, but it's a lot of acoustic guitar, drums, bass, and our lead guitar player joined us on most of our shows and the ones that he can make it to. And but when it comes to the writing of the music, it usually comes from sort of a bass, drums, and acoustic guitar. You know, so a lot of it is that, as the as the meat and potatoes of it. And then Aram Arslanian, he's our producer, engineer, lead guitar player. Wonderful guy. Can't say enough about him. He comes back and will layer his guitars and do the things that he knows. And so the music can kind of change in the sound if he shows up. If he shows up, we're going to get more bluesy and a lot more rock and roll. And so some of the music you would hear online or on the records, we'll get into that. But there is a chance that if you saw us at a place and Aram maybe wasn't there, you would get more of like a folk rock vibe because it's going to be acoustic guitar, bass, and drums. But at the same time, we bring the energy and fuck it up no matter what.
Right on.
You know what I'm saying?
Nice.
Not fucking it up in a bad way.
Yeah.
Yeah. But we get down wherever, man.
I can dig it.
Yeah.
Right on, man. What are some of your influences in music?
Some of my favorite bands, if I was going to go like classic rock type stuff, you know, Tom Petty would be way up there on the list. Led Zeppelin, of course. I grew up listening to Lynyrd Skynyrd. There was a time in my life where I couldn't even really get to sleep without sort of like going to sleep to some of their more down home, not the hits, but they came out with a box set, man, in the 90s at some point in time, and they were these just really swampy acoustic like songs that were just acoustic guitar and that guy singing, and it was just creepy, weird, unconventional style from what, like, and you could hear some talking and some, you know, things moving around, and it was just different. And I used to listen to that particular CD on the box set, and yeah, man, there was a time in my life where I couldn't really get to sleep unless I was putting that on, just kind of going, you know. I learned all the words, you know. Curtis Lowe, one of my favorite jams, and that's on there. Newer stuff, man, if I got into, like, as I got older and sort of, a lot of that stuff was introduced most likely from my older brothers or my dad. So my dad's a big Allman Brothers fan. I mean, that's how I got the name Dwayne.
Yeah.
really never showed up in that guitar way, though. I mean, I play guitar, but I would never consider myself anything close to what Dwayne Allman did in a short amount of time. Mm-hmm. He was so young when he died. It's crazy. So, but as I got older, I mean, you know, bands like Fugazi were a big influence. I really love Operation Ivy. I've been listening to them a lot lately, again, and revisiting how much fun. I mean, if there wasn't a better time either. I mean, it's summertime coming up, and they just, that's a good time party band. Some of the other ones, man, that from the 90s, like grunge scene, I always loved Pearl Jam, you know? I don't love all their albums, but, you know, when they get angsty and crazy, I love them. Their latest album's really angsty and crazy, though, so it's really good.
They put out another album?
Just last week.
Last week, yeah.
Oh, really?
Thursday.
I'll put that on the playlist. Right on. That's good to know. The whole original band?
Believe so.
Nice.
Yeah.
Good. I'll check it out.
My all-time favorite. Talking Heads.
Yes.
Yes. There's no other band that can compare. There's no one who's mimicked them or tried to mimic them or who's come even close to being anything that eclectic and weird and crazy. I love all of their albums. My favorite is the double disc that they did from the 70s, where most of it was recorded in someone's living room. They only had a few, I think maybe there were a four-piece at the time. Mm-hmm. So the band was still small, and the songs were done very different. Some of the hits are on there, a few of them, but they're done so differently, very punk rock aesthetic to it. Although they didn't have the crunchy guitars, they were playing, I mean, that stuff is crazy. They're sitting there in a living room, and these guys are intertwining their guitars like an old lady knitting a fucking hat, dude.
Wow.
It's incredible. If anyone out there wants to hear the best of the Talking Heads, try to find that double disc. It's like a 1977 or something like that, and they're in a living room. It's absolutely crazy. Wow. Guitar work. I've never been able to write music like that, though. I love those guys, but I've never attempted to sit around and try and, like, get quirky like them. They're
definitely super unique.
Oh, yeah.
We were talking about bands recently, and Charlie said there was a Talking Heads cover band, and I was, get the fuck out of here. I was like, who the hell is going to try and cover the Talking Heads?
Yeah, Life During Wartime.
The name of this band is the Talking Heads. Yeah. Is that it? Yeah. The double disc. And that's the pictures of them right there on the cover, of them in the living room. Just a bunch of kids shredding. Yeah, look at that. They're probably Polaroids.
Wow.
It's recorded really well, too, man.
That's awesome.
Nice.
It's recorded really well.
And that came out in the 70s? This is 2004. Oh, that's when it was probably released.
They re-released it.
Right on.
When that came out. I will research.
Nice.
Yeah.
Yeah. We'll check it out. New music. I love getting on, turned on new stuff.
Mm-hmm.
Good, good.
Lately, I've been listening to, revisiting some of their first albums, Band of Horses. I don't know if you guys are familiar with those guys. They had a couple hits probably 10 or so years ago, but, they've continued to play, around the world, man, and tour every year and put out albums. Some of the albums I like better than other ones, but generally, you know, you can always expect something pretty good from those guys.
Right on.
Yeah.
I'm not super familiar with their music, but the bar I worked at in Philadelphia, Resurrection Ale House, the owner was a big fan of them. And whoever was bartending, it was usually their job, like their iPod would get played on, they would get to play it. And then somebody was like, oh, we don't want to have that kind of music. So the owner put his iPod on there. And then we got this negative Yelp review. It said, we are the 1%. We don't want to hear the Band of Horses on repeat. Everybody was like laughing hysterically. And, you know, all these great reviews, you know, some shitty ones like, oh, the French fries were cold. It's like, there's this one about this specific band. We don't want to hear that all the fucking time.
They're reviewing the band.
Exactly. It was great. It's like, not ambiance, not food, not beer. Change the fucking iPod, will you? I found that humorous. That was my one interaction with that band. Yeah, man. Pretty cool. I could dig it. Yeah, man. Yeah, so you're a little bit all over, a little bit of everything for you. That's good.
Yeah. I dig it, man. I don't know that I get too much in. I don't know a whole lot about jazz. I have a few albums that I like, you know, jazz. Country music I dig. Mm-hmm. You know, but I, you know, it's more of like, I don't know. I shouldn't say I don't like new country, because that's just not true. There's a lot of new country artists that I love. Jason Isbell would be probably my favorite new country artist. But he's not even new. He's, you know, I think he's been putting albums out for a good 10 years or so. Mm-hmm. But George Jones, mm-hmm. you know, I've always really, really loved him. He can write the saddest songs. And still have you like hit and repeat on it. You know, we're
I can take it.
Waylon Jennings.
Yeah.
Big fan of his. Yeah, man. Merle Haggard. My uncle actually drove his bus for about 20 some odd years.
Wow.
Yeah. Merle Haggard was a. Was a pretty tough dude, man. He went through quite a bit, man.
Man.
Left home when he was probably about 14 or so. Yeah.
The old country hits different. Yeah.
Yeah, he never went back home either, man. He just traveled around and made a living, eventually, a really good living.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
In 1977. Oh, we recorded over, how many years did they record it? What does that say? It was recorded November 1977 to February 1981. Well, I guess because it's a double disc, right?
Yeah, so the second disc on that Talking Heads is an actual, like, proper studio where they, like...
Right on.
Yeah, so the first they one toured is, it. The, okay. is the living room
mm-hmm.
party. And then, the second one is, like, some of the hard hitters.
Right on.
They were doing some of those hits that came out, you know, on MTV with videos and all. They were performing some of those well before those videos and things came out. But that's where I fell in love with them. You know, MTV came out when a perfect time for myself and my brothers. You know, I was probably, like, maybe 4 or 5 years old, you know, just being able to understand, like, probably what's going on, you know. I'm sure I loved music, but I was probably more in the Flintstones, like, intro song. But my brothers would continue to listen. I remember all those videos. The Cars, they always had really cool videos. Of course, Tom Petty,
mm-hmm.
his were some of the best. Yeah. And Talking Heads, you know, they were super creative. They had all those... sort of just crazy wild dance things going on that seemed like this guy had no clue what he was doing, but you knew it was choreographed by some professional. Mm-hmm. And that's why it was good.
Yeah, it's a real performance when they get up there and do their thing. That's when Charlie said there was a Talking Heads cover band. I was like, man, and you said that, like, they put on the whole show, and I'm like, that's got to be a hard sell, man, because that's such a unique thing to pull off. What you got here? What is this?
So they just re-released Stop Making Sense, obviously, this past summer.
Oh.
And they did it in IMAX. And they re-released this. This is, there's all this rehearsal footage of David Byrne just coming up with all those weird dances he was doing on stage. And, like, it exactly like you said, he was just thinking about form and thinking about shape. And how he, and it looks so weird, but the stuff that he's doing is, again, is just so creative. And it was all just him. I mean, at least for Stop Making Sense. I can't speak for everything, but so you can watch this, and it's just like him going through, like, doing doing this kind of stuff.
And, yeah, yeah.
The dancing with the lamp that he did. Uh-huh.
Oh, right.
Like, practiced all, like, rehearsed all of it.
Looks like a peaky fucking blinder. Look at him go.
Yeah, he's certainly, he's an artist through and through. Yeah. The performance, the music. I mean, who knew you Full could give that kind of vocal delivery in a song and that people would just love it, you know? Like, yeah. Some of it, like, he's just talking and being weird and whatnot, but it seems to work. Yeah, look at that. That's awesome. Super, like, vaudeville type, you know?
Yeah. That's a great way to describe it. Look at that.
That's pretty cool.
Yeah, it's like some real Charlie Chaplin shit.
Yeah.
Oh, interesting. What a groovy dude.
He's still touring and playing music and doing all kinds of cool stuff.
Gotta create,
that
man.
Guy, yeah.
He did that, it was like a touring exhibition kind of thing where he would find these big empty buildings and like rent them out, and he put like a keyboard or something in the middle. And there would be like fans or motors or something just everywhere in the building, this big open spaces. So you'd play the building, you're playing the keyboard, but it's some motor going somewhere off in the building. You're just here with this like fan going or whatever it was.
It wasn't like notes playing, it was setting off.
Yeah.
Setting off. Oh, okay.
It was just like you're playing the building. That was the whole idea.
Yeah.
It was so, I mean, just weird.
That's pretty fucking cool. Yeah, some people are on different levels, man. There's levels to this game.
Oh, yeah.
I can dig it, man. Oh man, David Byrne. Yeah, that's a cool pickup. Yeah, I'll have to check that out. New music to listen to. I love getting that. So we had John Jennings from Ronald Records on here a couple weeks back.
Love that guy.
Record store, but also a record label. And you solo act and Lincoln's Beard were on that Banthology record they put out.
Right.
And you're also doing a record with Ronald Records as the label, right?
Right.
Talk about that process, please.
So he included my song, solo song, Stacy, on the Vanthology. And then as well, I want to say it, Hobo Heaven is the name of the song. Or no, sorry, Elk Hunter.
Elk Hunter's on it, yeah.
Is the name of the song from Lincoln's Beard that's on there. And so in the process of talking to him about the Vanthology thing, we started talking about other recordings, and we have what I call in the can now about two albums of music that were recorded over the years that we've never released. I mean, there may be more than that, but the stuff that we want to release that we're excited about, we have a good two albums worth. And so we thought it'd be nice to do another vinyl album. So we're doing another vinyl album. We'll put like 12 of those songs on the vinyl, and then the rest of them we will probably release digital. And so John was interested in releasing a vinyl through the record store and through his record label.
Nice.
And, you know, because we have this ready to go, and we got some artwork ready to go, and a gentleman, Chris Bauer, who's going to design the front cover, back cover.
Local all cat, kinda, right? Yeah.
Mm-hmm. And I think his outfit is Talented People.
Talented People, yeah.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. You see the stickers around town?
Yeah, yeah. And so he's going to design it all for us. And John's gonna put it out under his label and put up some financing as well, which is, you know, really important for us because, you know, all of this stuff is a labor of love. You're not doing any of this stuff at 48 years old because you're trying to be famous or anything or make any money.
We are well aware.
Oh, right? Yeah. Yeah. So, you know, the money comes right out of our pockets. Mm-hmm. And so when John stepped forward and said that he would help out, it really kind of thought, you know, well, this is definitely going to be a vinyl. We're going to put down the money. And, you know, I'm not saying that, you know, the vinyl companies are too expensive or anything, but for what they do, it costs a lot of money.
Mm-hmm.
I think they're working on a very thin profit margin, and it's just expensive to get vinyl done. But it's worth it. I've always thought, you know, vinyl, people give it to the Goodwill, or they try to give it to their friend, or they sell it at a yard sale, or something happens. But you'll never find them, like, tossing it in the garbage, right? Like CDs or tapes and things like that. They tend to live longer. They just get passed on, you know, and you could only hope that you know, it just survives. CDs that we made probably with other bands that we were in the past, I don't even know. Those things, I'm sure people have thrown them out by now, you know? You wouldn't be like, oh, I'm going to go sell this random CD from a local band back to the record store or something, or you know, that's kind of... And I'm talking about myself here. Mm-hmm. You know, that's kind of just a toss it in the trash thing. But if you pulled out a vinyl record and were like, I'm getting rid of some stuff and these records need to go, you wouldn't be like, all right, dump them in the garbage. You would put them on Craigslist for free, a yard sale, give them the Goodwill. However it would happen, the vinyl seems to have just a longer life.
That's a pretty cool perspective. Other
forms of, even like those. Remember those 8-track things that people had?
Yeah, they got some over at Ronald Records.
Yeah, those people were, you know, those were tossed out back in the day, and yeah. Hmm. So, for what it's worth in that regard, I think it's worth the money because it at least survived longer. Mm-hmm. It'll be here when I'm dead. Right on.
You got a time frame on the pressing of that?
We're hoping it comes out by the end of the summer. So I would say like August sometime.
A couple months, that's quick.
But if anyone wants to listen to any of the music or buy any of it, it's available all over the internet.
Right on.
Yeah, you can buy it, listen to it for free. You can get in touch with us on Instagram and buy a vinyl record straight from us. They're $15. It's a really good deal. It's a fold-out gatefold and a nice spine on it. And oh, yeah, and the music's pretty good.
Right on.
That's nice.
And the content is great, too. Beautiful. I can dig it, man.
Take the ribbon from your head. Shake it loose, let it fall. Lay it soft upon my skin. Like the shadows on the wall. Come and lay down by my side to the early morning. All I'm taking is your time. Help me make it through the night. And I don't care who's right or wrong. Yesterday is dead and gone, and tomorrow's out of sight. Ain't it sad to be alone? Help me make it through the night. And I don't care who's right or wrong. When I was talking about my hands, you know, and not being able to play music.
Yeah.
And so what brought that all on was a few weeks ago, man. I was at the Goodwill trying to give them a dresser It's a nice dresser, man. It was a white dresser. It was from IKEA. It's pretty nice. Mm-hmm. I just didn't want it. I wanted it. I didn't have room for it. I wanted it. I want a lot of shit. So I try to drop it off, man, and the guy starts looking at it, and he's like, I just don't know about this. And I was like, no, man, what are you talking about? I start pulling the drawers out. I'm like, check it out, man. This thing is nice, dude. Mm-hmm. He goes, yeah, but it's not solid wood. We're not taking furniture anymore. It's not solid wood. And I was like, bullshit. There's stuff all in there right now, man. All mm-hmm. kinds of furniture in there, whatever. So he goes and he gets his manager. I was like, man, this is crazy. Mm. The manager comes over. The manager looks at it, and he's like, yeah, I don't know. Can't take it. And I said, damn, man, that's crazy. All right, two against one. I'm taking this dresser back home, I guess. I put it in the car. And I turn around. I see these two dudes going back into the Goodwill, and then the door shuts. And I was like, pfft. I took that shit back out of the car and put it right back where it was. But I go to jump in, and I jam my damn finger in the door. And then that was, you know, for doing a stupid thing I was doing, I got, you know, immediate karma. A
little karma kicked in.
Yeah, man. And so I jammed my finger, and I was, you know, raising hell at myself, looking at those guys in my rearview mirror, shaking their hands because they walked back outside and saw it. Mm-hmm. And I was still trying to get out of the parking lot. They're shaking their hands at me, yelling, and yeah, I was like, oh, nothing's stopping me now.
Yeah, man. Make a getaway.
I'm gone.
So, and then, so that night, my finger starts to swell up, and then we have, like, a show the next day. And I was like, oh, my God, man, like, this is fucking horrible, man. I got a jammed finger, and I got to play bass guitar. I like to use this finger a lot when I play bass guitar. I don't use a whole lot of fingers. I should use more. If I was a better bass player, I probably would. But I just use these three here. And that's what got me thinking on that thing I was talking earlier about, what if I couldn't play, man? Like, what the hell? Then I just kind of went in circles on thinking about that and about how miserable my life would be, and that if it would be worth living if I couldn't play music, you know. It just ridiculous. It would be worth living. I got to say that, you know. I have a son. He's, mm-hmm. you know, he's quite the human being, man. Mm-hmm. I love him. And I have a lot of friends and family and loved ones that I want to be around for. So I'm joking when I say that.
Yeah. They love you for more than your music.
I hope so.
Yeah, man.
I mean, I don't think it's that good. Hell.
Yeah. On that Goodwill tip, Dusty Slay, the comedian, his new special is pretty good, but he was on the stand-ups, I think it is. It's like little 10-minute bits. He has a bit specifically about Goodwill not taking something he wanted to take he wanted to drop off.
And it's just more.
It was hilarious.
It's recent, you know? Yeah. They get really weird, man.
His whole thing was, oh, you're going to take it. Maybe not right now, but I'm going to come back tonight. You're going to take it.
Yeah.
You take it whether you like it or not.
I love those. Remember they used to have the trailers they would just set up in a parking lot? Oh, yeah, and you kind of just drop.
Yeah.
Oh, man. Mm-hmm. I mean, I know why they don't do that anymore. Mm-hmm. People are just dropping off trash mm-hmm. and stuff. But that was the ticket. You know, there was no one going to say anything there.
Yeah, man.
Yeah, so now I get selective about what I take there.
Hmm, interesting.
Which is really ridiculous.
There's some bougie Goodwills, too. I was in, what's the place? Hood River? There's like a boutique Goodwill. Yeah,
Goodwill.
I picked up something. I was like, it's a fucking $100 for this thing at Goodwill? What kind of Goodwill is that? I mean, I don't know what they're doing, but
no,
like hand-picking stuff and making it selective, I guess, but.
I was there yesterday buying a basket, and this girl's looking at it, and she's like, looks like someone's messed with the tag on this. And I was like, what? And she's like, yeah, it's a basket, man. This thing is like 6 inches big, man. Like mm-hmm.
A dollar. I'll give you a dollar.
It's $4.50 for this wooden basket. And she's like, I don't know. I got to check what's on. I was just like, dude, ring it up for $4.50. Like the world, you know, if we all start getting too goddamn virtuous and like doing everything correctly, this is going to suck. Just ringing up is $450. I honestly don't think it's worth $450, but I'm willing to pay it.
I am willing to pay $450.
But she wants to make sure it is $450 and it's not some other price that it would be. I don't know. But anyway, we came to a agreement.
Nice.
It was $450 plus tax.
Right on. Yeah.
And I went home with my basket.
Yeah, those Goodwill tag switchers, man. Ooh, look out for them. What's the color of the day?
Okay. The nicest
whatever it is, I got
one
it
in the world is up on 78th Street. The I believe she's probably like Ukrainian lady.
Mm-hmm.
She works at 78th Street one.
Mm-hmm.
Nicest lady in the world. Yeah. Love her.
That's the one I go to most frequently. It's across the street from the gym, yeah.
She's awesome.
Yeah.
She's been there for years, and she's always a sweetheart.
Nice.
That wasn't her yesterday. I was at the 78th Street Goodwill, but it was not the Ukrainian lady.
Right on. What'd you pull up here? Goodwill Boutiques. Oh, it's a real fucking thing. Look at that.
Yeah, yeah.
And there's Goodwill, what do you call it, like an eBay site, too. You could bid on shit.
Yeah, shopgoodwill.com. And, it's ridiculous because things get marked up there so quickly.
Yeah.
People are bidding. It's like you're paying eBay prices on Goodwill more than you would pay on eBay sometimes.
I mean, it's a business. It's Goodwill, but, it's the name of the business. It's a business. They got to make money somehow, too, right? I don't know where all their funds go to, but I've used it before. I got a Vitamix off of there, an old one, too, with, like, a fucking drillion horsepower fucking motor. It's a real fucking workhorse for, like, $70. It was great.
Nice.
So I was cool with that. But I don't think I'd go back and do the whole bidding thing. This is what I'm willing to pay for it. Like you said, this is what I'm willing to pay for it. If somebody outbids me, fuck it. It is what it is. But yeah, there's some good finds.
Yeah. Yeah. I used to, when I was living in Beaverton, there's one Goodwill where I would just find camera stuff all the time, which was awesome. Like, especially, it was just kind of starting out, and I found like a bunch of vintage lenses and adapters and stuff that would have been super expensive to find anywhere else or source off eBay or something like that. And they were right there. And then, of course, like some photographers get wind of it, and then it's all cleared out.
Yeah.
I was in there. Guys just got a cart full of cameras. I'm like, okay, I guess I don't get any of that today.
What's the other end of that? The ones where they could pull out like the fucking trays of stuff.
Oh, the outlets where they got the bins.
The bins. That's where they
call it. And it's all by weight.
That place is rough, man. You run into
that's one way to put it. Rough, yeah.
Yeah, they get a little aggressive and weird in there.
Aggressive and weird.
Yeah. You got to know the rules, and you're like, this isn't like a pool tournament, dude. Like, we're not playing league and shit. Like, this is the Goodwill, and you're just rifling through shit.
There's a bin. No,
this is my bin.
Yeah. Exactly. Stalk them out and shit, man.
Yeah.
And it's by the pound, too, right? They put them on a fucking scale or something like that?
I found the Goodwill to be very useful, man, when my son was young, because if that motherfucker left the house, dude, with a basketball, he was sure to not come back with it.
I know.
And so I would go to Goodwill and just buy every basketball and football they had, and it didn't matter. And he'd show up and be like, where's your basketball? I don't know. And then, but when a kid loses a basketball, you can't get upset because that basketball is in the hands of another kid somewhere. So, whatever.
Yeah, man. It was a thing at the park. You should find a ball, leave a ball sometimes.
Yeah.
It's like somebody's going to play with it.
Put your name on it. Yeah. That's futile. Yeah, no one's going to, let me return this.
Growing up on the East Coast, there's Goodwills and everything, but it wasn't a thing that I did. Coming out here, I see it's a little more prevalent. And I used it when we were opening a restaurant. It was like, you can go there and find some stuff. If you're cool with like mismatched plates and silverware and shit like that, you can get all that stuff for a song.
Mm-hmm.
Or closing restaurants now, which is happening more and more frequently. You can go buy all their stuff. But, yeah, it's a good way to outfit a restaurant, I think. Especially you got a small joint, need a couple tables, some plates and shit like that. Yeah, man. There's some scores, too. People go in there and treasure hunt, too. You find camera gear. I found some, what do you call that, all clad pans. $200 pans for $20. Yeah. I'm buying that. There's stuff there.
A lot of this gear here, these monitors... Goodwill.
That's right, yeah.
Dude, it says it right there. You got
a sticker on it?
I keep the stickers on it.
$24.99 for that one. That's a good deal for that. Get yourself a Samsung.
Are you a tag switcher, Charlie?
No,
not at all.
I try it. Because that seems like a lot of effort to get.
Yeah, exactly. $3 difference or something, right? I could dig it.
If I get a deal, great.
Yeah.
And same at Briz, too. They did the same kind of deal where... certain tags are 25% off, 30% off, whatever. go over there. I'm like, oh, microphone. It's usually a $40 microphone, $15. I'm picking that up. I'm like, never know.
I can dig it, man. Right on. Are you a gearhead? I know a lot of musicians are gearheads.
I'm not as bad as a lot of people are. Mm-hmm. I recently got, probably about 2 years ago, got rid of a lot of stuff. Mm-hmm. So, and it feels good. Mm-hmm. You know, I have less stuff now, but I only have this acoustic guitar that I love to play. And it's really the only one I do play. It was ridiculous to have another one or any more than that. And then I have one electric guitar that I love and that I've had for years. I don't play a whole lot of electric guitar, but if I need to, I have it. Mm-hmm. And then I sold the bass guitar I had and another bass and got, like, the one I wanted, mm-hmm. you know, that I was kind of like, it's called the Rumble Cat. It's a...
Rumble Cat? I never heard of that.
Yeah, it's just like it's kind of like a jazzy-looking style bass, but mm-hmm. Yeah, there it is.
Right on.
The plum sort of color, or I don't know, burgundy. Yeah. Rumble. And so it plays really nice. It's got a soft sound, and then the fretboard on it is more akin to a guitar.
Okay.
And so, because my fingers aren't really long, mm-hmm. it makes it easier to handle it. But more than anything, I love the weight of it. It's very lightweight.
Those are the ones that get played.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
I heard an interview with Derek Trucks recently, and he was talking about the instruments that he plays, because he plays, what does he play? SG Custom or SGs? And he was like, when you're going out, he was like, find the lighter ones, because those are the ones that get played.
Mm-hmm.
Those heavy ones, because, you know, Les Pauls and stuff, they're notorious for being super heavy and no way down on you after a while.
This one's also, you know, called, some people call it the Woody. Mm-hmm. It's designed by Alan Woody,
who's okay. Oh, yeah.
in Government Mule.
Mm-hmm. Oh, right on.
And they run, you know, they run right alongside Derek Trucks
yeah. mm-hmm.
and, you know, Widespread Panic mm-hmm. and those types of jam bands.
That's one of my favorite solos is, was it Government Mule? Maybe it was when they were doing Allman Brothers, but Government Mule guy.
The lead?
Yeah.
Dude, oh.
Warren Haynes?
Warren Haynes.
Yeah. It was, they were doing Desdemona. And I could listen to that solo over and over, just Derek Trucks doing it. I don't know why he went first and then Warren Haynes went next, because it was like, how you gonna fuck you gonna follow that? Mm-hmm. He's just a bananas guitar player, man. I love listening to that dude play. Derek Trucks. Yeah, man. I mean, coming up with the Almonds, too, I guess it's...
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Yeah.
Not a bad...
Yeah, not a bad beat there. Yeah. His band, Tedeschi's Trucks Band. Good stuff. I could dig it.
They're all playing right now. God, what is it? My friend just sent me some photos and stuff. It's all the Government Mules there, Widespread Panic. It's at a jazz festival in Louisiana.
Oh, right on.
That my friend's at. I don't know why. I mean, you know how festivals get. They call it a jazz festival, and it just kind of turns into all kinds. Mm-hmm. But, yeah, she was sending me pictures earlier and a video of, who is it? Dwayne Allman's son and Dickie Betts' son. Dickie yeah, Betts died last week.
Yeah. Last week? Wow.
I think it was last week or maybe the week before. Yeah, it's been recent.
Oh, he's been popping up on my feed. That makes sense, yeah. Mm-hmm. He don't get a whole lot of credit for carrying that band for so long.
Oh, Lord,
the music he wrote.
Yeah.
Dickie Betts, City 86? Oh, yeah, he just died. Look at that. April 18th. Oh, shit. Yeah, when I was... picking through some of their music, pulling up on YouTube, it was Dickie Betts and his son, and they were doing, I forget what I was playing, in memory of Elizabeth Reed. I was like, wow, that was pretty cool to watch it. He's still an intense dude, old man. He was like, make sure you get the shit right.
Yeah, you really got to look to find guys like this now, you know? Mm-hmm. Like, they're still around. It's like earlier when I almost, like, tripped over myself saying I you know, don't like new country, mm-hmm. you know? It's just I don't... enjoy what's on the radio type country. But there's plenty of great country artists out there. Mm-hmm. But same thing with these guys here. You just have to look for them a little bit more nowadays, you know. And there's just so much to sift through on the internet too, you know. Mm-hmm. It's really a double edge.
I mean, there's so much music out there too. Southern rock, I like that genre. Almonds specifically. Listen to Dixie Dregs at all? Remember that band?
Mm-mm.
He was Steve Morse, I believe his name was the lead guitarist. Dixie Dregs. I used to listen to them back in the day, too. Dixie Dregs. What's a guitar player's name? Steve Morse?
Yeah, man, that guy looks like he's rocking and fucking rolling.
Yeah. Steve Morse, yeah. When I was learning how to play guitar, 90s, he was in a lot of the guitar player magazines, you know, with a free tablature in the back. And I was like, man, I don't even know what half this shit
is. Is this guy's money?
Yeah, right? Yeah, that was the stuff back in the day. When I first got a guitar, the guy my sister was dating at the time, he was a very accomplished guitar player, and would just come over and be like, you know, trying to find common ground. I'd be like, hey, here's a handful of guitar players. And I was like, that's how I learned some licks, man.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, man. Gave me a Jimi Hendrix book as well. I was like, all right, guess I'm playing guitar now.
Yeah.
Yeah, man.
Tackling the big ones.
Yeah. Yeah, there was some stuff, some Led Zeppelin stuff too, you know, picking around on that. Because that's what I was listening to at the time. Yeah, man. Good old days, Augusta, Georgia. Yeah, they rip, man. If you never listened to them, put that on your list. If you're into that style. We're not.
No, man. I'm sure I would like them.
Yeah, man.
Augusta, Georgia, I'm sure. I don't know why the hell I didn't know about them. I mean, that's Augusta sits right on the border of South Carolina.
Mm-hmm.
Hmm.
A bunch of members. They might
word play. Didn't travel as fast back in my day.
Yeah, man. Pre-cell phones. I can dig it, man. Cool. So you put down a couple of tracks already. You got a couple recorded. You want to... are we still hearing music over... Hearing stuff next door? Let's hold off on that.
Kind of, yeah.
We'll see. We'll give another rip in a bit when they quiet down a little bit. You have an electric guitar. Do you play... I mean, it seems like you're doing like singer-songwriter stuff here. Do you play lead guitar at all? Like no. Get into it and noodle around at all?
No, I'm not very good at it. I'm more of like the path I followed was more of like a songwriting path.
Right on.
I've been always, like I was saying earlier, just enjoyed trying to put the puzzle together in that regards. Mm-hmm. And then, you know, usually... I try to come to the table with that, you know, some songwriting skills and the ability to play bass and acoustic guitar, and then probably, you know, always in search of a drummer and a lead guitar player. I mean, not currently, but like, at, you know, when you want to form a band, that would be the piece that I usually try to fit into.
Do you have a formula you like for writing music, like music first and then words, or... You know, do you write it down or pick it out?
You know, I don't know so much as it comes and it goes. Sometimes it comes pretty frequently for a short amount of time. And when I say short amount of time, like maybe a few months.
Mm-hmm.
And then I try to capture as much as I can because I've learned that it probably will slow down for whatever reason it is. I don't even know. What it is, it's just as life kind of goes, you feel it at times and at other times you don't. But I do know what works for me is early morning sessions, kind of just waking up and really fresh to the day, having some coffee, and there's really no one up. And there's no text messages or phone calls or anything. And there's also not any stress of anything sort of coming through the pipe, right? Yeah. Like to take your mind off of what you're doing at, say, like 5 in the morning or whatever. So I found that that's a good time for me, for someone who gets distracted easily. It's a good time for me to write. And so... and it usually comes at that time. Very rarely will I write in the afternoon? Or I mean, sometimes I'll tinker with songs when the band is together, you know, for rehearsals or whatnot, and that'll be in the evening time. But most likely are coming to the table with sort of something that's almost fully done, but maybe we can add some parts or switch some parts around, nice. And which is, such a huge, huge part of my songwriting, as well as bringing it to my bandmates and having them listen to it, think about it, and start, you know, being like, well, I like what you're doing here, but maybe we could put this here. And then you start to switch things around, maybe add something different to the end of the song, an intro. You might even find that some of the parts of the bridge, you know, aren't that good, and that someone else has a better idea for something that could happen at the bridge. And that's when a lot of it comes together, you know, and you could almost call that co-writing at that point.
Absolutely. Moving the puzzle pieces around, like you said. Yeah. The puzzle, yeah.
Yeah. So, I mean, I have to give a lot of credit to my bandmates, because there's a lot of songs that we have on some of these albums that they were a huge part of. And then, of course, Christopher Chrysopoulos is our lead vocalist. I do a lot of singing, but he probably sings the most songs, but he's willing to take songs that I've written, and he'll sing those. And then he writes a lot of songs as well, and comes to the band almost in the same process, very open process of, what do you think? And don't be scared to tell me that it's either no good or that these things need to change. Mm-hmm. And then every now and again, you know, the song is so simple and so straightforward that it's like, that's it. You know, if you mess with it, then it's just being too forced, right? So every now and again, you come to the band with a song and it's just ready to go. You just have everybody kind of throw their pieces on it. Another big advantage is that I don't play drums, you know, and I don't play lead guitar, right? Yeah, so all of a sudden, these guys crank it up. Mm-hmm. And then Chris will back me up on vocals, you know, at time, if I'm doing, you know, lead vocals on a particular track. And to have those people backing you up feels so good. And then you start to believe in the song, right? And believe that you are a songwriter. And so that's why I call myself a songwriter, because I've been through that quite a few times with the help of what I would call a team. Mm-hmm. And it's been very successful, and I feel, you know, really blessed to have those guys, and fortunate, however you want to say it, right? And that's part of the songwriting process. As far as me, you know, having any kind of like a formula or thing that I would follow or whatever, I've never been educated enough on songwriting. You know, from the beginning, because it's all been shooting from the hip for the entire time. Mm-hmm. I just kind of felt like, oh, I can kind of do this. And then when you get around other people that think they can do it too, right, you all start faking it until you can make it. And then before you know it, you're like, oh, wow, I can actually do this. Mm-hmm. And then it gets even better when you have a group.
Yeah, get it in the room, workshop it. Yeah, that's beautiful. Do you, at those early morning sessions when you're having your coffee and writing music, are you physically writing it down, or are you recording it on your phone or a device, or just memorizing it?
I'll record it on my phone, and then I'll write it down on a paper. I'll write a lot of details, mm-hmm. In case I've kind of, you know, go about my day, and because once you get your day started, you know, I'm probably working by like 7:30, 8 o'clock, mm-hmm. And it just goes, right? And then you can almost forget that you were up at 4:35 in the morning, right? You know, and so I often will just kind of like, oh man, what was I doing in that morning session? And so I write a lot of details down, you know, reference dates to the phone, mm-hmm. You know, what key it might be in. a lot of different, if I had different ideas for, say, a chorus line, I would write all those ideas down and write, you know, like A, B, C, meaning that, like, I like the first one more than I like the second one. And it gives me a reference of kind of somewhere to jump off at when I get there the next morning. Mm-hmm. I don't have to really think about it. And then I think you guys could really, you know, I don't know how many times you probably yourselves been playing music and you wish you had recorded something that you did and you were like, oh my gosh, like I did something there and I can't remember exactly what it was. Mm-hmm. I don't know why it escapes you like that. It's horrible. It's a horrible trick the world plays on us.
Yeah.
So I try to avoid those moments.
Mm-hmm.
So I'll record everything and yeah, and just hope that I can get back to that point. That way I'm going step by step. And I like to give it, here I am telling you I don't have a process. And I'm telling you the process.
There it is.
This is so stupid.
That's why I asked the question. That's so beautiful.
And so I'll give it a few weeks, and it usually takes me an average of about a month to kind of work on it in the morning on a daily basis. Not even daily basis, at least 4 or 5 days a week. And really taking a word out, even just a letter, instead of saying a little bit, mm-hmm. you know, whatever it is, to in order to get the words out and the phrasing that I need to get them out in, I never force anything. If the story starts to get mumbled and jumbled and I'm like, it doesn't make sense anymore, I don't fucking care. It's serving the song as the words mm-hmm. need to go along, you know? And so I give it that time, and I used to not do that, though. There was a time when much younger, thought to myself that these things need to come really natural, and if it doesn't come natural, then it's just not a song. And then whatever words I wrote down needed, like, they had to be, that has to be the song. Can't change these lyrics, you know, that type of stuff. And it just doesn't work, you know? It's just kind of like sort of like building a piece of furniture and then, you know, having to sand the edges and polish it up. And, you know, there's a lot of things beyond just like putting that piece of furniture together. You know, you need to, you know, get the edges off. It needs to look aesthetically pleasing to the person so they buy it. Mm-hmm. So I feel the same way about a song that... You have to just do a lot of things after you've had this idea. You start playing these chords, you start singing these words, you write them all down, you know, please do, or have it recorded, right? And then you just start picking it apart, you know, like it's worthless.
Yep.
Who wrote this shit?
Mm-hmm. Yeah, man.
Until you can find something in there that you're like, okay, this is a cohesive sort of song here. Not meaning cohesive as in the story makes any sense, but as in like how it feels when someone's listening to it, right? So
I can dig it, man.
And then sometimes the story does work out and you're like, oh, I'm brilliant. But you're not.
There's that ego. That's beautiful. Yeah, I highly recommend, having, you know, played a little bit in bands and whatnot, I highly recommend just record everything. Every rehearsal, every jam session, get it all, because you never know when those nuggets are going to come out.
Yeah, yeah. And it's worth it nowadays. You know, you use up a lot of memory on your phone, mm-hmm. but there's other things. There's worse things that could happen.
Yeah, exactly. A little SD card here and there, transfer it, whatever you got to do. One of the, we started playing, you know, it was a garage band and whatnot, but after the first couple of sessions, I was like, we need to record all this. I went out and bought something, and it had a CD burner right in it. So sometimes we'd have like a really good part or something. I could just throw a CD in there and burn it, be like, hey, let's all take that home.
Oh,
we'll come
man.
Back to that. It was yeah. pretty cool. Yeah. And I would go home and, you know, put it on the software that SoundForge, I think it was, by Sony. This is when Pro Tools was hot, but I was like, I'm not using Pro Tools. So I got some different one I paid $600 for or something. But I would listen to, you know, we'd play for 5 hours sometimes, and I would try and just chop it up into tracks because it was all jams. And give each song a name, and everybody got a CD next time, you know. And I got stacks and stacks of CDs at home of just lots of jams.
Yeah, yeah. That's and awesome.
The one we didn't get was probably the best one.
Yeah. You know? Oh, really?
It was, I'll tell this story real quick.
That shit.
We had this cat, Mitch Gibson. I think I just started following him on Instagram. I just saw him pop up. Artist, musician, his brother was a pretty famous singer. They were touting him as like the next Stevie Wonder, white Stevie Wonder, had the blue-eyed soul. And then he became born again Christian, started singing Christian music. So we kind of, not necessarily fell off, but you know, went a different direction. But Mitch, his brother, always wanted to sing and you know, was kind of overshadowed by his big brother. So we came in this garage band and Holmes could blow. And he was an artist, would write poetry, and we would just jam. And sometimes he would just grab his poetry book and start hitting it. His pop had died, and Mitch didn't show up to the session for good like 4 or 6 weeks. And we all, everyone knew what was going on. And he came in, he came back, and he would just sit in the corner and not say anything, not sing, and just drink a bottle of tequila. 1 or 2 weeks it was coming, boom. We started playing, Mitch is in the corner. We started hitting something. I think I was playing saxophone, and it was, I was riffing on the intro to John Coltrane's Alabama. It was just a simple horn line. People started coming in. It was nice, soft, mellow. I'm like, cry. And Mitch got up and started singing about his pop, and it was fucking beautiful. And I went over and I hit the button. We got done. Everybody's just looking around, and fucking missed it. I didn't hit the right button or something. And it was,
oh, man.
It was just for that time, for that moment. That was his first one back, and he just started singing again after that.
Yeah.
It was beautiful.
And he was back in.
And he was back after that,
Took him a little bit, man.
Yeah.
Oh, man.
Yeah.
But he was still coming to rehearsal, huh?
Yeah. It took him a little bit.
Yeah.
And he'd come back and just sit in the corner and drink a little bottle of Casadores and wouldn't say nothing to nobody. And we all know, we gave him a space, and, you know, it was just – safe space, you know, and he knew we were all, and that was that band too. We called it the Workshop. It was in, you know, Freddie Nazal's garage. He played bass in high school. He was an older man. I think he turned 50 when I was there, but he started playing music again because his wife had died. And I wrote it on a board many years ago, but it's something I'll never forget. He started playing music again because he said music was the healing. You know, these people coming together and creating and help him, you know, through his grieving process. So everybody was welcome. It was, you know, a big party garage band. We'd go there and, you know, people smoke weed and drink beer. And the first like month or two I would go to it, it was really jammy. And then it started getting serious. And I was like, oh, you're going to lead the band. And then it got smaller and smaller and smaller, and it got a little bit more serious. And it was a really cool time in my life. And some really cool things came out of it.
How old were you then?
I think I turned 30 in San Francisco, so like 29, 30. Yeah, it was good. Yeah, 15 years ago, 17 years ago. Really cool times. I still talk to some of those people too, you know, people in the band, Jackie, Mitch, Freddie, Nahil, and Tadek, Chris, his brother.
They all still live out?
A lot of them in San Francisco still, yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah, some of them still making music. I mentioned Chris Powder P. Back in the day, you know, had a flip phone, and Chris played trumpet and percussion, and he was a tremendous musician. He was also a DJ. But I remember we were trying to get together on some horn lines, and I had a flip phone, and I would like sing a horn line into the phone and send it to him. We'd be sitting there at the session, like, all right, man, trying to harmonize on it. Yeah. Different technology now. We probably pull it off a little bit better, but it was good, man. Yeah, record fucking everything, man.
Yeah.
That's good. You guys recording everything now, Charlie?
I mean, we're trying to record a lot. It's, you know, with down here in the basement, I don't know. I want it to be a step above, you know, just the cell phone recording. Whatever's fine.
Mm-hmm.
But I've been trying to, like, set up a camera and get some stuff just so we can hear it. And even like there was one song where it's like we play it really well. It's just like, how do we end it? And so eventually we just worked out an ending, but we didn't get it on the same take as we played. So I just like sliced it up. I'm like, here's how it should end. Here we go. Listen to this every time. You know, it's really handy.
A good tool, man. Yeah, yeah, definitely.
Great. All you need is that idea, man. And be like, woodshed this baby.
Exactly.
Play this over and over.
Exactly.
I mean, we got limited time to practice. We're all busy adults. Mm-hmm. So I'm just like,
adults. It. Look at you classifying yourself. Right on. Mm-hmm.
I got a badge. It says it. I can show you.
A card carrying member of the adults.
So it's just like having, being able to go back and like, what do we play? Do we even have a set? It's like, yeah, we got like 20 songs. Yeah, man.
Yeah, man.
Here you go.
Yeah, and I haven't played in so long, you know. I used to know a bunch of songs on the guitar, but I haven't played. I've forgotten more than I know now, you know? I can grab the thing and play maybe two songs, but it's like back in the day. It's like, oh, yeah, I could play a bunch of songs. You don't do it. You lose it a little bit.
Yeah.
Yeah, man.
Yeah, I haven't played a solo show in a while, so I kind of haven't been playing as much. I moved to a new apartment, too, so I've been kind of just messing around with that thing a lot. Mm-hmm. Like, I don't know, man. I do the 6 month move in, you know, like you move in and you just walk around that motherfucker for months going, I wonder what I need here.
Yeah, exactly.
Oh, you know what? Maybe a plant right over there.
There you go.
And I moved my refrigerator like two or three times.
The refrigerator. Wow.
Yeah. It doesn't have like a place where it really goes.
Yeah, normally there's a spot for the refrigerator.
Yeah, this motherfucker just floats, man. So it never looks right anywhere.
Interesting.
I just keep moving it around the refrigerator, you know, or not around, move the refrigerator around the refrigerator. I move the refrigerator around the kitchen, and I'm like, that doesn't work, and I leave it there for a day. And I think I'll get used to it, and I'll get used to it. I found a spot for it now. I'm kind of happy with it, but I may move it again.
This bedroom has a refrigerator.
Yeah. Maybe that's it. I should put that thing in my bedroom, man. That way I don't have to get up in the middle of the night and get Swiss cheese. I ate Swiss cheese.
Don't put it in the bathroom, whatever you do. I mean, I don't tell you what to do, but.
I used to have a roommate in college, man. He was always busy doing class. He would eat on the toilet, man. Gross, dude. He'd be in there eating a ham sandwich, man.
No.
Yeah. Horrible.
Economy of movement, I guess.
Yeah,
crunch it all together.
Making the most of his day.
Oh, it makes me gag a little bit.
He did better than I did.
Perspective. Maybe not that. Oh, whatever you got to do. Yeah, man. I can dig it. This is great. What else? Tell the people about the shows you got coming up again so we won't miss on that.
Oh, okay. So the next one for Lincoln's Beard is on Friday, May 10th. We're playing with a band called Resurgence, and that's at the Brick House in downtown Vancouver.
Wow.
In addition to that, we'll be at the Three Peaks Public House out in Ridgefield this summer. They do a concert series. I believe ours is towards the end of the summer, July 26th. But anyone interested in that, it's every Saturday. It's a beautiful place. There are some folks who ride horses there. There are horse trails that go to it. There's a great restaurant next door, you know, the Pacific Fish House. The is that the official name of it? What is it? Is it Pacific?
Pacific Northwest Best, PNWB.
Yeah.
Pacific Northwest Best Fish House.
Yeah.
That sounds about right, yeah.
It's a wonderful place to eat, and they have these free concerts all summer long. They're every Saturday at 6 p.m., so not just Lincoln's Beard, but you can catch many of these local bands or bands that are passing through. I'm not really sure who all they have on the schedule for this year, but I'm sure it's a lot of really cool bands. They have a big field there. It's full of picnic tables. Kids are welcome, of course. And like I said earlier, they put some bartenders and whatnot outside to serve beer as well, so you don't have to go inside. So you can just kind of hang out there the entire time and enjoy the music. And there's quite a few other shows. We're going to do a waterfront show. We're playing acoustic, and it's going to be filmed by We Are Vancouver, which is a friend of ours, Johnny Driver, who just kind of covers a lot of the Vancouver scene video-wise, and every now and again he'll come and record us playing a show or whatnot. And so he's going to come down there. We're going to do an acoustic sunset show, and I should know the date on that, but I don't. But
I'm sure it'll be on the Instagram or something. Yeah,
yeah, yeah. We got posters and all that stuff coming out nowadays.
Is there any like a specific space down there? Or they have like out on the pier, or is there like a little amphitheater? I don't know.
No, we're just doing it out on one of the platforms.
Oh, right on.
Not the pier, but the platform that's closest to the water structure.
Right on.
Yeah. No, we haven't asked anyone. Just doing it.
Yeah, that's what I like to hear. Yeah, yeah. That's the way to do it.
But it'll be a lot of fun.
Mm-hmm. We were out there. We went to the pasta joint. There was that dude busking on the corner.
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah. It's nice down there at sunset. You know, there's a lot of people.
There were a lot of people.
Walking around. And, and it just, you know, it's not necessarily, I mean, anyone, please come. But it's not necessarily an invite thing. It's really just to kind of create just more and more entertainment down there in general, you know, for the people that are there. Yeah. I go there in the morning sometimes and play guitar and just sit on this same platform.
Mm-hmm.
And you'd be surprised at how many people come up and just sit down next to you and just enjoy the music for a little bit, and then they walk on, you know. Very rarely does someone actually speak, like, to you, but every now and again someone will be like, hey, thank you very much, you know, or something like that. And I put my guitar case and stuff on the opposite side of me, and I close it up so it doesn't look like I'm really asking for for tips or anything. So I think people feel a little bit more comfortable just approaching and being around, that it doesn't look like they might have to tip for doing that, you know, like, I don't know. But it is a nice spot. I don't necessarily go there at sunset as often as I do at sunrise. But I know at sunrise you get a lot of joggers, a lot of people walking their dogs, not as many like larger families and stuff. So it's kind of a different crowd. But I think the sunset shows would probably be serving a larger, you know, population of people that are walking through, families, kids.
Yeah, it's a good play, I think.
Yeah. But it's cool down there, man. I don't know that I can afford, like, some of the stuff that's going on there.
Yeah, that's why there's no families down there.
Yeah, yeah. But, I mean, it's a nice spot. I tell you, if you were traveling, you know, up or down the 5, you know, say you were, I'm just thinking, like, my family, you know, comes from the Carolinas, and they're traveling up the 5, and they have no idea. They're looking for an exit to get off on. Mm-hmm. This is an incredible, this is crazy. Mm-hmm. You could get off here with your family, get one of these hotel rooms, dude, you and your wife or, you know, significant other, whoever, just do whatever you want to do in the hotel. Turn the kids loose, man, to go get ice cream and do whatever. And then you can even just walk a few blocks and end up on Main Street here with a totally different scene going
on.
And no one ever has to call an Uber. No one ever has it. You're within just a few blocks of wherever these kids are, right? Mm-hmm. So if they're like, where you're at? You know, it's like, oh, we're just up on 16th Street, not too far away. Whatever it is, right? It really is an incredible stop. And so in that regard, I can see why the prices are. I'd be willing to pay anything too, man. You know, if I was like rolling down the, you know, in an RV with kids and stuff and everybody screaming and yelling, like, I'd pay $20 to get this kid out of my hair. Go get yourself a milkshake, kid.
Exactly. Go get that milkshake garnished with a hamburger.
Yeah. Yeah. So I appreciate what they've done with the waterfront for us locally by leaving, you know, a whole area that's a park there. They could have easily just put them right on there and told us we couldn't go to the waterfront. But so I appreciate it. I have my, you know, jokes and things that I make about the prices and things like that, but I know what they're doing. They're up to, you know, what they need to be up to is making money for this area trying to secure that all this stuff exists in the future. I went to a place the other night, though. Wow, the Witness Tree. You been there?
No, I never heard of that.
It's 8th floor of the Indigo Hotel.
Oh, okay.
Pretty nice spot.
Oh, yeah?
Yeah.
Right on. Restaurant, bar?
It's a bar.
Bar, right on.
Well, they have...
Rooftop bar?
Yeah, can get on the rooftop there. It's really nice. Really, really super nice. People work there and stuff. But again, you know, it's an expensive place. Yeah. But, you know, you get what you pay for.
Yeah.
That view is incredible up there.
Nice.
Yeah.
And they're building, like, what's the plans for a land bridge from, like, City Hall area to go over there too, right?
Really?
Yeah, I believe so. We talked about that with Jordan a little bit. Yeah. I don't know if it's, like, green lit or anything like that, but that was the plan, I think.
proposal.
Yeah. Proposal, as they call it. Thank you.
A walking land bridge. Yeah. A walking land bridge is what they call it. Yeah. You can walk on it.
Yeah.
It's really a...
I guess it's going to go over the train tracks or something, like from there. I don't know.
Oh, really?
Yeah. I mean, I don't know the design or anything like that, but that's what I had heard.
That'd be cool.
Yeah, like the other one, the land bridges over there.
Yeah, the Confluence, whatever.
The Confluence, yeah. Look at you. You know the whole downtown.
I've walked the Confluence.
Yeah, the Confluence.
Yeah. Right on. Cool, huh? You want to play us out of here, Dwayne?
Watching you move, it's making me crazy. I've been watching you soon. You be my lady. There's no one here, you and me, let's dance. Move our feet across floor and find a groove that you will never lose. Shining on the light bricks, cross room, it's looking. I'll be watching you move. It's making me crazy. I've been watching you soon. You be my lady. There's no one here but you and me. Let's dance. There's no one here but you and me. Let's I'll be your man, I'll back ball and steal until I can. Treat me good, you can treat me bad. I don't mind, you got money to have. Been watching you move, baby. Making me crazy. I've been watching you soon. You be my lady. There's no one here but you and me, let's dance.
Thank you very much. I really appreciate it.
What you see, what you hear, is what you get.